Hi, I'm Scuffed Logan Paul, and welcome to Bootleg Content Cop. Ethan Klein has done a lot for the YouTube community, and his main channel videos are pretty funny. So why am I making this video? Because he's a hypocrite, and because he can't take criticism. This whole story started with Ethan taking one big risk.
Most of you guys probably know Leafy is here, a popular YouTuber who's been blowing up big time. I'm actually friends with these guys, so it's awkward and it's uncomfortable. But if for some reason, we as a community have been giving these guys a pass. And I mean, if you look at Leafy's channel, all he does is make fun of kids and like vulnerable people. No, there's no sport in making fun of these people. It's just sad. It's stupid, honestly, that we've all gone this long giving these channels a pass, who are cancerous. I'm serious.
So Ethan calls out Leafy for bullying kids and bullying disadvantaged people in his videos, and, you know, I'm not upset about that. That's not the issue here. The issue is this.
And, like, look, me and Leafy are friends, you know?
You're friends with this guy?
Me and Leafy are friends.
All right, so you're friends with him. So how exactly did you get to this point? Like, actually, I'll let you play along at home. What do you think? Did Ethan, A, discuss the video with Leafy prior to uploading it? B, upload it with no warning whatsoever? Or B, because the answer is B. All right, so right off the bat, that establishes that Ethan's goal in this was not to stop Leafy from bullying kids. It was to stir the pot, to get some drama going, to come out as the hero. And I'm fine with that. You can do that. I love stirring the pot. However, you made one crucial little error.
I really just want to see his channel die out. I fucking hate him and his channel. Don't give Pyro a platform to defend himself.
Me and Leafy are friends, you know?
Oh shit, we're friends! I mean, that's terrific, man. I mean, I should have known since you literally were sucking my dick about my channel about a month ago. Happy for you blowing up. You got a unique style and personality, man. You worked hard to get where you are, and you deserve it. It just pisses me off to see Pyro writing yours to undeserved success.
This was the first time that we got a good look at the true, jealous, manipulative side of H3H3, or Ethan. He's straight up calling Pyrocynical, a psychopath, cancer, no goofs, no gaffes. This is his honest, unfiltered opinion between two peers in the same platform.
But recently, I've actually had a lot of private messages sent to me of H3H3 giving me a lot of shit, saying how my channel is cancer, saying how I'm completely unoriginal, and I'm a total sociopath.
Now, Pyro, being a level-headed and self-aware guy, came out on this position on top. Do you know why? Because he knows how to handle criticism, he knows how to deflect it, he's smart.
Now, even though Ethan said all this shit about me, and I'm pretty sure he'd kill me if he saw me in real life, I'm gonna respect his privacy and not show any of these messages. Except that one, because it's genuinely funny.
But what happens when the peasant calls out the saint himself?
Does H3H3Productions go to him and say, "You are cancer, motherfucker, I said it here, and I'm gonna say it now, you're cancer"? No, dude, guess what he does? He fucking lies! He tweets out saying, "Why you straight lying, dog?"
Oh, okay, so here it was also revealed that Ethan directly lied in a tweet to Pyro. When Pyro had some suspicions that Ethan was conspiring against him with other YouTubers, Ethan immediately said, "No, dude, why are you spreading lies?" Ironic.
Can you just find, like, someone to pick on your own size? Like, I mean, seriously, dude. What's going on? You're just picking on kids. What's cool about that? Clean cut? I wouldn't exactly call it clean cut. He's got the hair of a fucking 6-year-old dude with a goddamn shitty toupee.
So Ethan was. He was recruiting a army of small channels to basically try and conspire against Pyrocynical. You know, like, wow. instead of doing a video yourself, you decided to gather a bunch of cronies and get them to do the dirty work. Slowly get them to try and topple this guy. Well, I mean, that sure blew up in your face.
But what does the saint known as H3H3Productions do after he's been caught lying?
He fucking licks Pyrocynical's asshole, dude! Look at this shit!
Now, after this whole debacle, Ethan immediately went into damage control. He professed his love to Pyrocynical, he said Leafy was a scumbag for releasing his DMs, and, you know, that was basically the half-assed apology that we got. You know, in retrospect, I can't even imagine how gleeful you must have been when that content cop was released. Well, wait a minute. You helped iDubbbz create some of the points for that video. Well, look at that, Ethan. You ended up getting what you wanted. You got to bash somebody through the mouth of another. Okay, so Ethan, let's be clear. You weren't really friends with Leafy. You talked in the DMs, you bashed Pyro together, but really, you weren't friends. So already we know your definition of friendship is a little bit loose. JonTron, however, is undeniably a good friend of yours. I won't even deny that myself.
John's the reason we came out to New York. He gave Ela a job producing when we were pieces of shit. We had no prospects, no money, no job. John said, "I'm gonna take care of you, kid. I'm gonna give you guys work. I'm gonna give you guys purpose." He brought us out here.
So when JonTron gets in trouble for the debate with Destiny, where he said some controversial things, you kept quiet about it. I mean, you make it clear that you disagree with what he said, but you know, you stay silent pretty well. You know, you don't discuss it publicly, which is okay. That's a perfectly fine response. You know, he loses if he supports John, because the public opinion at the time is that JonTron is an alt-right idiot who doesn't know what he's talking about, and that's a fine reaction to have. It's smart. Okay, just keep that situation in the back of your head for a bit. Now, around the same time, PewDiePie gets in trouble for some bullshit, complete, you know, horseshit. And Ethan, you vehemently support PewDiePie, you know, and you should, because you're his friend. And because he's right, but also because you're his friend. You know, you should always support your friends when they have more subs than you and public opinion is on your side.
It's a joke. He's not serious. There's a big difference, guys. Context matters. As a Jewish person, I'm not offended.
Flash forward. PewDiePie's in hot water, man. He said the N-word.
Yeah, he dropped the N-bomb, and he dropped it pretty hard. It was more of just like a Hiroshima. It's pretty much worst-case scenario. You know, when they drop nuclear bombs and the people out on the street have, like, shadows left over and printed on the sidewalk? It's like that.
Get off your high horse, you pompous fucking prick! Oh, my God!
I don't think Felix is a racist person, but god damn, he really kind of just was really comfortable using that word. That really just kind of...
I love that I can just say nigger faggot, though.
Yeah.
Yeah, man, he really just dropped the N-bomb, like, straight up. And the way he used it was just awful.
Nigger faggot whore. It's just a wonderful string of words that really gets you going.
We say offensive things privately when we're joking with our friends because we all find it funny for one reason or other. But goddamn, dog, you're freaking live streaming.
I feel like you're using a little liberally.
I love saying nigger faggot. It's so wonderful.
Yeah. So now you're going to get shit for it.
There's no excuses this time.
I can't defend him. It's completely indefensible this time.
Yeah.
What a fucking nigger.
Ethan, why'd you do this? Because it's a hot topic, and you want the public to know that your views are rock solid. Do you know why I know this? It's because you're a disingenuous, opportunistic person who is not afraid to ride the wave of hate, so long as it stays away from you. But it didn't. You got called out for this one, big time. Because people saw you got a little too cocky. You got a little too confident.
H3H3 uploaded this podcast to YouTube, and it has over
28,000 dislikes on his most recent podcast. Almost more dislikes than likes on this thing.
They think that Ethan H3H3 is being a hypocrite because on his podcast, He said the N-word too!
So I'm sure H3H3 will like clear this up in his next podcast. Definitely no hate to H3H3 or anything like that. He's a great dude, and I know he'll come back from this, obviously, right? I think he's just gonna have to explain it more.
You're right, Johnny boy. Papa Ethan can do no wrong. He'll explain this all away. He'll make us understand.
We can be friends, and you can still criticize me.
Yeah.
But you have Keemstar and Scarce, who are like, H3's a hypocrite.
Oh,
because he said nigger on his podcast. You call yourself a news source. Like, get fucking real. I have nothing to apologize for. And somehow now I'm getting more shit than PewDiePie.
H3's a hypocrite. Mm-hmm. I didn't watch the podcast, but this guy says he's a hypocrite. And I didn't have any content today, so I'm going to post a video, and I don't really care about what it actually means. I'm news, but I don't actually look at things beyond surface value. I'm Keemstar. But I make news for 12-year-olds.
Keemstar and Scarce made these fucking, these plebeian videos without even watching my podcast.
Yes! Oh, we got ciggies, we got beers, we got the boys. What more could you ask for? The pinnacle of moral authority.
And to Keemstar and to Scarce, shame on you. You're my peers. You take yourself seriously. You made a fucking joke of yourself. I have no respect for either of you. You know what? If you think I'm wrong, if you think that I'm a racist and a hypocrite, if you didn't bother to watch the podcast and you downvoted and you left a mean comment and you called me a hypocrite, fuck off.
So, unsubscribe. Yeah,
don't watch. Don't watch.
Because we'll have a lot less of that shit to
enjoy
deal with in
Keemstar,
the future.
Enjoy Keemstar, the pinnacle of logic and sanity on YouTube.
Yeah.
Go enjoy his fucking show.
Bye-bye.
Where everything he says is well-researched and rational and reasoned. Keemstar.
We'll see you in a month.
The fucking guy that looks like...
you dumb bitches.
Yeah.
You know Jax Films did not want to be there. Because he knows how the internet works. Very well.
Time to have a mental breakdown on live stream.
Oh, Ethan's a hypocrite. Fuck off. That unsubscribe button is
fuck
right down there.
Off.
Click it. And go subscribe to Keemstar, hit that bell, and enjoy the ride. And in 3 years, when you grow up, come back here, because I'll be waiting. The H3H3 production has always been all about logical. We break it down, and we think about it. That's why the social justice warrior criticism comes in. You're going to tell me, who's been making fun and lambasting and discrediting these people for years, that I don't have this right?
Ooh, that's a big yikes from me, man.
Fuck off.
Right.
Listen to the fucking podcast. Keemstar's your source of factual information. Disconnect your internet, dude. Fuck up. I am not sorry. Think for yourself. That's what this is all about. Keemstar's the pinnacle of free thought. Drama alert. Welcome to the stroke victim nation. What a fucking
over
loser.
Here, you're watching actual... professional comedians with their hot
this
takes.
This is a fucking nearly 40-year-old man who thrives on making videos about Jake Paul. Let's turn to him for the news. Fuck off. I'm pissed off, dude. Clearly. And I got nothing to apologize for.
Am I saying that you're being a hypocrite? No, I am not. I am saying that people are mad at you and they're disliking your podcast because they are claiming that you are a hypocrite. I call myself a news source because I report the news. And this is the news. People are calling you a hypocrite.
This is a fucking nearly 40-year-old man who thrives on making videos about Jake Paul.
Oh my God, bro. Dude, this is your channel, dude. Jake Paul, Jake Paul, Jake Paul, Jake Paul, Jake Paul.
Like, according to the internet, you're 32 years old, I'm 35. You're only 3 years younger than me, Ethan.
Your whole channel is making fun of people and criticizing people, and when you're criticized, what do? Blame somebody else.
Basically, you said anybody criticizing you and calling you a hypocrite is a 12-year-old. So you could delegitimize anybody's argument. Oh, they're just little kids. I'm right and they're wrong because they're little kids. And then you try to manipulate even more by saying, the reason why I'm getting hate is because Scarce and Keemstar. And then you use a leafy line, Keemstar is just a 40-year-old who makes Jake Paul videos. Apologize, admit that you're wrong, but you guys won't do that, will you? Because you're better than everyone else. You're never wrong.
Now, guess what happened on the next H3 podcast?
I think the only thing I really want to apologize for is that drunken rant. And, you know, about the context hypocritical thing, I don't think I'm a hypocrite. Most of the people who were upset about it probably didn't watch the whole episode. Because the harshest criticism I landed against PewDiePie was that I was disappointed.
Hey, future Chris here, real quick. I need to clarify and make very clear the point I'm trying to make here. Ethan, the issue here was not that what you were saying was wrong. It's that you were the wrong person to be saying it. You emphasize heavily that he was live streaming when he said it, and that he sounded like he was very comfortable using it. And then there's footage, man, of you being super comfortable saying it on a live stream multiple times. Like, are you had to have forgotten that that clip existed. Otherwise, you'd be a complete idiot for saying that at all. Like, just think about it this way. Why do you think iDubbbz did not say anything? Because he's smart. He knows he's the wrong person to be saying anything about the situation. He needs to stay silent. Whereas you just wanted to use it as a fresh scoop for the podcast, and it worked. You got the clickbait, you got the views, but people realized you were a hypocrite. It's like if Bill Clinton called out Donald Trump for being a sexual deviant. Your point is just immediately invalidated, even if it's right. Plus, you even pathetically tried to bring iDubbbz into the mix and say that you would understand if people criticized him.
And first of all, I understand people who would criticize iDubbbz and say that's fucked up the way you use it.
So basically you're admitting that you would understand if people criticize you, but you don't. Because you're a hypocrite and in your mind, nothing that you do is wrong. You can't take criticism. Anyway, back to old Chris.
I'm going to see an old friend. Trying to take a look.
Oh, I got this machete, but that's mine.
Yeah, okay.
But I've got this, like it works for what it's for, but like it tastes better than what it's used for.
Holy fuck. Is it loaded?
Yeah.
Oh, you fucking liar. you want it? I know you want it.
Oh, I fucking want it.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Dude, this is nice. I like this.
Yeah, it's nice, isn't it?
Yeah, how much?
It's 500.
Did you do three?
I'll do three, but like, you got my stuff?
Yeah. Boneless or fucking deep fried? What are you feeling?
Oh, definitely boneless. I've had a hard week.
Alright, fuck. 300 boneless memes. Think you can handle that shit?
Oh, I can more than handle. I need that.
Yeah.
So whatever stops the shaking. Never mind, there's flies in here.
You want any fucking Demi Lovato overdose memes, dude? I got fucking extra, they died real quick.
It's a dead meme.
Alright, I sent the memes. Am I good?
Yeah, you're good. Thank you. So why do you want that?
Honestly, man, I'm gonna kill H3H3productions.
Why? The perpetual good guy of you too? Why would you do such a thing? What the fucking
What are you still doing here, man? I gave you 3 months to move out, you're still here.
Just fucking chill, man. I just work here.
So?
Do you wanna buy a gun?
Yo, do you know where my brother is? Shit, I forgot I had him. He's actually in my closet if you want to see him. Okay.
I keep people in my closet.
Here he is.
Hey, Chris.
Oh. Hey, Nick. Why'd you put a fucking bag over his head?
I can't tell him where he is.
I guess that's fair. Alright, Nick, I'll be back for you in a bit, okay?
Okay.
All right, I'll see you Monday.
It'll cost you.
Oh, okay, fine.
Okay. Nick! Where did I go wrong?
I lost a friend somewhere. Remember how we talked about JonTron? Yeah, well, a whole 8 months after he lost his sponsorships and, you know, he was basically ridiculed off the internet. Well, you had him on your podcast.
Oh, you've always been an incredibly generous and gracious friend to us.
Thanks,
dude. And I genuinely love this guy.
Dude, and we miss you.
I know, I miss you too. It's been too long. Now that I'm officially, you know, guest number 8,600,005.
31.
Not that many.
Not that deep. Just kidding.
Did you see that reaction? Like, that signals to me that JonTron wasn't really welcome on the podcast until the dust had blown over completely.
You can go to represent.com/JonTron. I think that's the link, but it's on represent.com.
Represent.com/JonTron.
Actually,
that should take you there.
Sorry. I never did like merch before, really.
So we have a call
number.
Oh,
they're linking in the chat to your store.
Oh, they're linking in the chat. Great.
Oh, cool. Awesome. Thanks, guys.
You had an infamous debate.
Holy shit. So after 8.5 months, and after everybody's basically forgot about it, now you give JonTron a platform to defend himself? Well, I mean, you know, if you and John agreed to do this beforehand for him to discuss it, then that makes sense. That's fine.
It happened. How long ago was that now?
I don't keep track. I don't know. It was like a year or so.
I don't remember. Wow, has it been that long?
Yeah, like 9 months or something.
So if you're uncomfortable with anything, like, you don't have to comment at all. Like,
I don't really want to get into this. It's a minefield of sorts. I'm not going to go back and nitpick everything I said and say and qualify it or anything. I'm not really going to get into it. But, oh, yeah, I guess the main question on everyone's mind is, oh, is he a racist? Is he a Nazi? No, I treat every single person with the same respect they afford me. That's basically my full statement.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I mean, do you feel like you said some things that you regret?
Yeah, I don't like reliving it. No, I don't.
Did you have a lot of self-aware moments during that?
Of course, the whole time.
You're just like,
I was like, I should not be here.
I was wondering that. I saw you. I was like, I'm not the person. No.
I was just, like, I'm not the person to fight this battle.
Right. <yeah. laughs> Well, let me just say for the record, like, that I disagree with a lot of the stuff you said.
I really don't want to get into this. I would like to move on as quickly as possible because I just really don't want to get into this. I just want to make people laugh. That's really, I'm not trying to get back into this. I just treat people with the same respect they give me at the end.
Right.
Don't want to hurt anyone.
Yeah.
System, that's me. Don't want to get into it past that.
Okay. Fair enough.
Is that fair enough for you?
Yeah, fair enough.
Okay.
I kind of want to ask you, tell me if you don't want to talk about it.
Yeah, Ethan, I don't think he wants to talk about it.
But
yeah.
I wanted to ask you stuff that I find interesting.
People still want me to do comedy, so
Clearly, yeah. I mean,
I've just continued down that path, and I don't really feel like dredging it up because it's pointless. Yeah. Not going to get anything else out of me from it. not you.
Yeah.
There's nothing. I have nothing to say.
I'm just more interested in, like, the journey you had of, like, you went through it. It was something that sucked, obviously, and a lot of times passed. And, like, you feel like you've learned a lot from it, or you're in a better place now from
certainly
it.
Certainly learned I've definitely learned, like, one of the biggest things I've learned is just, you know, how to have restraint.
And you were in an emotional state at the time.
Yeah, I was in an emotional state. And I'll tell you one thing.
Not defending, by the way, I just want to say for the record, I'm not defending what you said. Just state again for the record, I disagree with a lot of the shit you said, okay. But that's fine. Like,
but
it's
we
okay.
can still be friends.
Yeah, I'm not going to be
we
like.
We can still talk about it.
That's part of the problem is that people were like, "I can't believe that you're still friends with John," and I'm like, "Why? He's the same person. Like, I love him. He's a good friend of mine. Like, we can talk about this stuff amongst each other and try to find a common ground, right?" Like, it's way better to have have a conversation and try to understand each other. Otherwise, you just end up with these segregated groups, people who hate each other.
Yeah.
Like, you really expect me to just be like, fuck off. Oh, Ethan's a hypocrite. Fuck off. You said something that I disagree with and I can't talk to you anymore.
That nobody's talking about our Twitter. He doesn't pick a side, so you unfollow him?
Like, that's how sick is that?
That's why I didn't want to get into this too much. It's something that... I'm just focused on comedy now.
That's totally fair. I understand.
Which, by the way, you're doing very good.
Thank you,
because your last videos were really good.
Thanks so much.
Like, what was this? Like, yeah, and I noticed you. I mean, you.
And he keeps going. My God, how does he do it, man? You know, and it just keeps getting worse. Immediately after this, he segues into talking about his depression. He makes it about himself.
You know, the audience doesn't think about this. They just see the fun.
No, totally, and it's frustrating. Anyway, it's a conversation for another time. But
yeah, no, I don't want to get, I don't want to probe too deep.
I'm just
here.
Thinking about it. It's fine.
Dude, you're gonna come out on top. I guarantee.
I want to talk about it, but I need to think about it a lot.
Yeah,
more.
Think it.
When I saw this podcast, it made me realize that Ethan is the Iago of YouTube. He isn't friends with you unless he has something to gain. You know, maybe he's friends like Leafy friends. You know. Like that kind of friendship, but unless you have something directly to benefit him, you're not friends. Like, seriously, notice how everybody who he openly claims to be his friends, all the friends he includes in his videos are wildly more successful than him. It's because he's opportunistic by nature. I don't even know that I should blame him, but I will, because he is. I mean, I genuinely don't think he has ever collabed with a smaller YouTuber. You know, take that how you will. He has no obligation to, but it says something, considering how many friends he has in the community. But sure, he'll have John on the podcast after not talking to him for 8 months. But we all know why that is. Because he wanted the fresh scoop. He wanted the juicy details. He wanted JonTron to explain to everybody how he got those fucked up ideas in his head. And this is classic. I mean, this is not a one-off situation. Watch the podcast for so long and you'll definitely notice something. You might not notice it directly, but anytime Ethan feels he's superior to a guest, he makes it blatantly obvious. One of the worst occasions of this is the episode with Jimmy Lee. Now, I'm going to try and make this brief, but if you do watch this podcast episode, it is insane the amount of disrespect that Ethan displays for this old man. He opens the podcast by basically bashing him and discrediting him as a comedian.
His comedy style is essentially roasting people he's never met before. I mean, Jimmy emails me very frequently. He pretty much emails me like 5 times a day. We're best friends. He emails Ela too.
Except I ended up blocking him. I gotta keep my inbox clean, you know?
It wasn't personal.
I gotta see.
But I endured it because I'm like, Jimmy's a legend. I mean, the guy's a legend, so. And Jimmy, he's a legend.
Then after talking shit about him, he welcomes him onto the podcast.
Jimmy Lee, welcome the legend.
The guest actually reveals himself to be kind of, you know, a decent guy. And everything's going kind of okay until...
But they create an effect.
Got it.
And an illusion is really what it is.
Right.
So it's a marketing tool.
Is it possible... Are you going to be there the whole time? It's a little hard for me to focus on...
Are you filming?
Are you filming?
We have 3 cameras in here, Jimmy.
I mean, I don't mind the guy here, but it's hard for me to focus on you when
I'll leave. Get out, dude.
Oh, can he stay and do stills or no?
Not really.
No.
Okay.
We'll do the stills.
Thanks,
all time.
Dude.
Okay.
All right.
Okay. Sorry.
All right. Well.
And for some reason, this interaction gives Ethan the green light to just fucking ruin this guy's day.
Like it's no secret, like between us, that it can be awkward for people to be around you, right? Like, you know that you elicit that response.
Why do people think that when I'm just a funny guy trying to have fun? Why does that perception happen?
You don't know?
No. Or I hear dad jokes or cringe, and I'm
just a completely obnoxious, callous fucking asshole the whole time.
It is.
You
powerful.
Seem to be very focused on race, like when you do your bits.
Well, I was a marathon runner, and that's part of that reason.
Yeah, why is...
Oh, you said God. I was focused on race,
right.
And it's because I was a marathon runner
right.
when I was younger.
Right.
How'd she get that and you didn't? Race?
Well, I don't know why.
It was bad.
No,
it was bad.
No, it was good. I just kept hearing you say blacks in my mind.
Yeah.
And I was like, is it racist to refer to black people as blacks?
So Ethan's clearly just looking for reasons to not like this guy. And he focuses heavily on the fact that his jokes are dated and they're kind of racist in a way. And oh my god, did you see that? Look at this. My god, Ethan. So we just got a good look at the Google Doc he uses to question this guy. And wouldn't you know it, it outlines every single question he asks.
For me, and I got a big outfit. And
so you're a successful dentist. What is your passion? Is it comedy or dentistry?
Well... I wasn't doing this for money. I'm not making money doing it.
Right.
It's a passion from here.
So what does your wife think about the...
She thinks I'm nuts. And I got my oldest son that thinks I'm nuts, and my young one thinks I'm hysterical.
What does she think about all the female attention you get?
It even has some of the fucking jokes that he uses.
Jimmy emails me very frequently. He pretty much emails me like 5 times a day. We're best friends. He emails Hila too.
Except I ended up blocking him.
So now we know why he was so pushy during the JonTron interview. When he has an agenda, he just goes with it. He doesn't give a fuck. He doesn't even listen to what the people are saying. He asks the questions he wrote down and doesn't even care to transition them properly.
That's kind of a personal question, right?
It's funny because who would do this? That's why I don't get the people. Don't get
that's me. Why it's funny. Yeah. Who would do this?
That's why, Hila, we have to get famous so people
well,
expect
you know,
to see it.
That's like, you know, that's almost like murdering your whole family and then being like, who would do this?
Well, it's okay,
it's funny,
I'm famous
right?
Now. People
it's
expect
cute.
It's cute. It's funny. Who would do this?
I'm not that crazy over the line.
You're not that crazy.
No.
But that
never,
would be funny.
I would never hurt a person. I just want to be noticed. And have fun. That's really all it is. We had fun.
Yeah. We had a good time.
We had fun.
We had a lot.
We almost got killed a little
yeah,
bit.
Yeah, it was a good time.
So they're having a normal conversation. The guy just seems too human, right? So Ethan has to dehumanize him by doing this.
That's exactly what happened. It was actually Ethan a fluke.
So do you want to roast one of us? Because you're like a roast comedian, right?
Yeah. But all of a sudden we're having this serious thing, and now I got to go into Jimmy Lee mode.
Let's do it.
All right, so who am I roasting? Am I roasting?
You can start with me.
You want me to start with
Hila,
you?
Take it, Hila, poor Hila. Yeah, I can take it.
Well.
Okay, this is a dance monkey dance situation. For those of you who don't know what that means, when you say dance monkey dance, it basically describes the desire of one person to have another person perform a trick for their entertainment. It's generally really demeaning, and the person asked to perform the trick is usually devalued for satisfying the request. Now, in this situation, Jimmy is being very fucking nice to Ethan. He goes through with it. He tries to his best to be funny on the spot in front of all these viewers. But Ethan doesn't want him to be funny. He just wants to demean the guy. So after so long of the guy trying his best to be funny, he actually kind of succeeds. And obviously, Ethan doesn't like that, so he looks at the script, and he tries to take him down by saying,
"Hey, Jimmy, do me a favor. Take off those glasses. You're making a spectacle."
Oh, I never heard that joke before.
"Hey, Jimmy, how long have you been white?"
"I'll be black with you in a minute."
What? I don't even get the jokes. Like, I don't
no, one of my new mean. One of my jokes is when I do the blacks, I have my whole setup. But
the
when
blacks.
When I'm done, I go, "I'll be black with you in a minute." I added that one in.
That's powerful.
It is.
You
powerful.
Seem to be very focused on race, like when you do your bits.
Well, I was a marathon runner, and that's part of that reason.
Yeah, why? Well,
and I'm dead serious. Like, this is uploaded to their channel. It's still there. You should watch it. Because it's just insane that this guy who's actually being very respectful and answering Ethan's questions, he just gets the fucking cold shoulder.
Whew. Let's keep watching, man. This video is spectacular.
Okay.
It's brutal. I feel like you have to acknowledge that watching this is brutal.
I love this shit. You know why? I grew up on Don Rickles. I have a lot of older people that have been coming to me years, and they love me, and they get me because they're 50 to 60, and it's the old school jokes. And I know who not to do it with.
Mm.
It's two different personalities.
All right, let's take a quick break.
Sure.
Our sponsors,
you know,
briefly.
What I like is the fun with the seriousness and the juxtaposing it.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And we're doing it great off the cuff. Back when we were really young is when there were two comedians. You see, in the 70s, 80s, it was one, but when it was this 50s, 60s.
All right, Jimmy, we're going to take a quick break.
All right, I'm
running to the bathroom. We'll be ready in like 3 minutes. I'm not going to lie. I'm fucking in. I'm in over my head.
Seriously.
Is this inner? I feel like I have no control over this.
I feel like I have no control over this.
You had complete control of this podcast, Ethan. You asked all the questions, and he answered them. When you were interrupted, he didn't fight you. When you told him what to do, he would do it. The only reason the podcast failed is because you wanted it to. You wanted to rag on this old man, and you succeeded. And Hila's no angel, okay? When this guy goes to the bathroom, she fucking literally suggests that they kick him out.
Say, we could bring Dan with the news after the break.
And Ethan loves this idea because he goes through with it. He does it.
Oh, okay. My God, dude. Guys, I'm sorry.
I feel like I have no control over this.
Thanks for joining us today.
Thank you for having me.
It was a pleasure.
My pleasure.
I hope you don't get stabbed.
or shot.
No.
I wish you health and happiness and all the attention.
What
in the
is
world.
Your What is your advice for me?
I think you're too mean. I think you have to tone it down a little bit.
And we finish now.
You're being. Or? You know, in the.
Am I being ejected?
You know,
it's the ninth inning. Jimmy, I'm being ejected.
You know, in the old cartoons gags, they'd have like a long cane and they pull you off stage.
Is that where we're going?
Yeah.
Jeez.
Dan, bring out the giant cane.
Okay. Well, thanks for having me.
Thanks
I love
for
you
coming
guys.
Out for us. Thanks for coming. I love you too, buddy.
I love you. Yeah. And you have an open invitation a couple hours.
What's
email
the address?
Me. It's the Peninsula
no,
Hotel.
No, don't say it.
Ooh! Beep! You know where
Sorry,
I'm at.
I shouldn't have said
you
up
you
on
can,
that.
You can email me if you want.
All right, Jimmy. God
thank
bless you.
Kids.
Thank
I love
you.
You.
Thank you. Thank you,
peace
everybody.
Peace and love and H3H3 rocks.
Thank you.
And of course, once he leaves, they talk shit about him.
I didn't want to be too rude. That was what
you
I did. Was worried
I thought
about.
You had the perfect... tone though.
Really?
I think meeting a meme is always a risk.
Right.
You don't know what you're getting into.
I don't, like, I can't sit in a room with Jimmy for like 2 hours.
Part of the
I think
brand
our biggest
point.
Mistake was not bringing any cringe
we should've,
gear.
We should have come in a hazmat suit.
In the hazmat suit.
We should have put his ass in a hazmat suit. Yeah. Like with Jimmy, I'm like, I hope it works out. And then half of me is like, I hope it doesn't work out. So I don't have to sit in there and deal with this shit.
And what makes this perfect is that during the interview, Ethan made it seem like the guy was racist, that his jokes, that were clearly jokes, were racist. And then 5 minutes after the old guy leaves, he says this.
Chanel for banning dabbing.
There it is.
That was a brutal dab. BLT formation for
it's like
a
minute. Scary yeah, dab.
Hold on.
That was like a fucking jihad dab. That was like a fucking straight up... Allah Akbar dab.
Here we go. We're going in slow-mo now.
Wind up.
Whoa. Boom. Damn.
Dude, that's when the bombs go off.
I treat my answer really, I just treat people with the same respect they give me at the end.
Right.
Don't want to hurt anyone.
Yeah.
Just, that's me.
Okay, so Jimmy Lee had a very small following, if any at all, so Ethan felt that he could act that way toward him and he would get minimal backlash. But what happens when he treats another YouTuber with disrespect? Well, this is William Osman. He's an engineer who makes very creative and very interesting videos. Now, a while ago, his house actually burned down, and obviously that was a pretty, you know, devastating experience for him. But one of the projects that he was working on was a beanie that talked, and it was made for Ethan specifically. And that video garnered a lot of attention, and finally, after about 5 months, William was invited onto the podcast. However, there was one small little issue with William's channel. He only had 600,000 subscribers. You see, when you look back at all of the YouTubers that have been on Ethan's podcast, there is not a single one with less than 1 million subscribers, except Eric from Internet Comment Etiquette, which is a great channel, and you should check it out. But he is included always with Jax Films, and Jax Films obviously has a lot of subscribers. So he's kind of supplementary, you know? And as well, Eric obviously is well known for bouncing on his boy's dick.
PewDiePie right. did nothing wrong.
Come the fuck on. It's not a multi-layered fucking issue. Don't say the N-word.
It's not that complicated.
But other than Eric, William was the first person to be invited onto the podcast with less than 1 million subs. You know, for once, Ethan opened the doors for someone who was up and coming. So why do I say this is an issue? Because he wasn't given a full episode. He was given a 20-minute time space on an episode.
They said we're going to be on for like 20 minutes. That doesn't make me feel like a very like special guest, but sort of an on like a temporary, I don't know, you know what I'm saying? Like supplemental to whatever show. So what we've learned is that we're not exciting enough.
Some creeps online. I'm going to teach these kids a lesson.
And when you watch the episode, there is very little substance to this hour-long episode of the podcast, and William could have easily filled that time.
This is a very mediocre episode.
We're just sitting here.
You know, every time it's like, this is the best episode. No, this is a very mediocre episode. Let me be upfront with you.
But, okay, whatever. You know, 20 minutes is still better than no time at all, right? So let's just see what they talk about.
So the story of this beanie's creation is also an interesting one. Interesting, a nice word for tragic one.
I'll show you the fridge. We got...
That's the fridge.
Oh, where's the...
Fuck.
Oh, there they are.
Oh, my God.
We got... Look.
How do you... What's the process like of like, okay, you go to the site, everything's gone.
Mm-hmm.
Like, what do you do?
It's a very lost feeling. It's not a good feeling. It's... Imagine everything stripped away. You don't know what you're doing the next day. You don't know what you're doing the next week. You don't know anything. And
what's the... Like, the thing that you really were depressed about losing that maybe you didn't expect, but...
It wasn't having lost something, it was just not being able to sort of jump back into everything as instantaneously as you do every day.
Mm-hmm. So for the sake of saving you some time, they basically just talk about how his house burned down for a good 15 minutes of his 20 minutes. And obviously, you know, if this were a full-fledged podcast, then it would make sense for them to go on about this for a while. But he only has 20 minutes. So basically, the majority of his time was spent talking about a devastating situation he endured. And to their credit, Ethan and Hila seem like they do care. But immediately after this, they transition swiftly into the talking beanie.
Well, I'm happy that you made it out.
Me too.
I mean, you really saved the most important thing, really.
I agree.
You went and you got the beanie. And
not joking. This really was high on my priority. Not specifically because of you, but because it was the video, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, it was for you, Ethan.
Let me try this thing on. Let's see. Let's.
Oh.
Shit.
We got sound effects.
Turn it up, Dan. A small chance exists that I will set on fire and kill anyone who wears me. God bless. I think I did the bit.
Nice. That was good.
Thank you, everyone. Round of applause for the beanie guy.
So far they've talked about his house burning down, and he's presented them the beanie. So what's next?
All right, that was great. I had a lot. So thank you very much. I'll say, William.
Yeah.
Thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
So that's it. They just wanted him to come on, talk about his tragedy, and then give him the beanie and get out.
Well, once again, thank you so much, William. And really appreciate you coming out here all the way from Ventura. Yeah. You're
you guys
great.
Want to come up to Ventura and do shenanigans? We have some shenanigans.
We have shenanigans in Ventura.
We can come here too, but if you guys have any shenanigan idea.
Despite making some promises during the podcast.
100%. Okay. Yeah. I think that we definitely will have some shenanigan ideas.
Yeah, it's gone.
There has been no collaboration attempts that I have seen.
Anyway, thank you, dude. God bless. They really appreciate you coming out here.
Thank you.
And it's sad because this is like the perfect YouTuber for them to collaborate with. A nice, fresh-faced up-and-comer who has creative ideas. It would be perfect. But Ethan doesn't care to collaborate with people who are below him. He only looks above. And it's a bad fucking idea because you're gonna end up getting hit hard with a lot of people realizing that you don't care.
All right. God bless, man. Thank you. So I don't know how to transition because we don't have a break.
Do I need to leave now?
You don't have to leave. You want to hang out?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. So we've got, let's see, we're moving on. We are moving on to the goddamn freaking Ian's beat. This was great.
By the way, did you say that we just posted a video?
We just posted that during the break. What a multi-talented beanie god I am. Thank you.
Do you schedule posts or do you just send them?
No. We never use the schedule.
There's not enough planning every
day. So you're videos exported and it's on.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
For the most part. At the best, maybe, well, I'm going to say at the best. The only reason I want to post it, I think the beanie's
still
literally
noises.
About to explode.
I think it's.
Oh, is it this?
I think it's this.
Why you?
Oh, this.
It's not our table.
Well, I don't know. I don't know. I'm new here.
Yeah, the video's up. But at best, we'll unlist it overnight because we'll finish at like 10 p.m. and posting isn't really an option.
That's really early.
At 10 p.m.?
Yeah.
To finish a video?
Yeah, we pull all-nighters pretty much every single time.
Yeah. We used to do that.
We used to.
But
I
think...
We're trying to be healthier.
Yeah, I'm trying to have a life.
And not do that.
Excuse me.
It's hard. No, all right. It doesn't always happen.
We have to bring Ian in. We have an update to Ian, the intern. Well, we got to play the song when Ian enters.
I know, but we got to also.
Oh, for Christ's sake. Oh, my God.
I got to set up a two-shot.
We got a two-shot, right.
Is this live right now?
Do you guys mind? Yeah, we're live. Do you guys mind swapping out?
That's fine.
This is...
Oh, yeah.
This
yeah, because we're
we didn't plan to have
up.
Two guests at once. Ian, or William, God bless you. Everybody, please check out William's channel. I'm going to put a link in the description. Yeah, please leave that there forever.
Oh, yeah, right.
Forever. Okay, get that. Throw that out the window. I'm gonna put it here. All right, Ian, come on. Come get ridiculed.
And, you know, the disrespect didn't end there. After the episode was put publicly, the initial title was Booty Doctor Films Patients and Coughing Beanie. Like, that's a shit title. Why not just put the guy's name in it? He has a fucking significant following. 600K is not nothing, man. Anyway, the viewers picked up on this very easily, and the title was changed. Although for some reason the booty doctor description was extended, so you can't see his name in recommended. And I do think that this lack of respect that is displayed by Ethan is largely to do with this fucking micromanaging of the podcast. We saw already that he has scripts for his podcast and he has questions, and clearly this is causing issues because he sticks too closely to his shitty scripts. You know, this is a fan and a fellow YouTuber who was very excited to come on, and rather than exploring his mind, you limited him to two things, Beanie and fucking fire. This also kind of explains why the Bill Burr podcast went so poorly. But you see, the difference is that usually the person who Ethan brings on is well aware of who Ethan is. And so Ethan feels a degree of power, right? Because he's this authority figure or whatever. But Bill Burr doesn't know who the fuck Ethan is, and he doesn't care. And Ethan went into it assuming that he would already have respect. He felt like he didn't have to earn it. And Bill Burr's a very grounded guy, and he fucking shattered that illusion, and it was beautiful to see.
The great Bill Burr? Hey, here today.
I don't know about great. Give me somewhere
the to greatest.
Go.
Greatest.
Oh, the greatest.
The greatest guy sitting across from you right now. The NCAA.
There's a lot going on for the great Bill Burr. With the great, great, greatest Bill Burr.
Oh, Jesus.
I do mean that, by the way. Right. I know it makes you uncomfortable.
It does. One great was bad enough.
Does it? But you know that.
Like, I like being appreciated.
Yeah, okay.
Just say,
tone it
back
down.
With the person I appreciate.
Yeah.
Once again, the that great, kinda, that's great mind
that's his,
that I appreciate very
that's,
much.
That's his finishing move.
Well, I love that moment. I love everything you do. The great, great.
This is how you turn it around. This is how you turn it around.
Where
made you uncomfortable. Now you fucking sit there and compliment me.
Those guys. Very, very funny gentlemen. Good people.
Good people, yeah.
There you go. All right.
What are you going to say at the beginning? Tony, you are... the greatest, greatest, greatest God, comedian. I do it to everybody. Don't
I
you?
Don't. I swear to God, I don't.
No.
But you know what I'm going to tell
kidding,
him?
Man.
You know
I'm
what
kidding.
I'm going to tell him? I'm going to say, I appreciate you, Tony.
Okay, cool.
We don't. The great Bill Burr doesn't have time for that.
All right.
Now, I'm not ragging on him for being nervous. I'm ragging on him because his superiority complex was shattered, and it was revealed that it's actually an underlying layer of insecurity that is driving him.
See, you're, that's part of, I feel like that's a new thing. You're already worried about your daughter being sexually assaulted, you know. How old is your daughter?
I don't think that is. I think that's you projecting your OCD on me.
Hmm.
It's
you're talking about, you know.
That she said three words and she totally communicated like.
Right.
That's so
yeah.
Cute. It seems like you're in love with your daughter hearing you talk about her on the podcast.
Jesus Christ. Well, you're pretty perceptive. It's like you care about your own child.
Listen, more than that, okay?
And you also had a zillion kids, so I mean, yeah.
Really? How many siblings do you have?
I don't know, dude. The internet's too fucking weird to give out all that information.
Oh, you don't even want to say how many because you're afraid that it will somehow
compromise
your privacy.
Yeah, by all means, keep talking
privacy.
About it. Is there anybody you can cut this out? I'm honest, dude. Like,
seriously?
Yeah, no, dude. There's fucking lunatics out there.
Okay.
Well.
Off the air. Off the air, I'll tell you.
All right.
Jeez. I love how surprised he is. Jeez.
Well, you can mention the amount.
Absolutely crazy people.
Well, okay, yeah. No. This is one of the first times I heard about you. I was in college, I think, at the time. It was when you were getting booed by thousands of people in Philly.
I was hoping you were. I was like, when you said my favorite YouTube video, I was like, oh, God, not the Philly thing again. Mm-hmm. And then you did the Sherry's Berries. I was like, I love this podcast. Now I hate you.
Oh, no.
I love what can I do? I love that.
I'm joking. I'm fucking with you.
Okay.
Yeah, let's do it. Oh,
no. But do you... But,
bring a hat,
no, I'm not going to ask you.
We're booing. And you've been booed before.
You've talked about this a lot.
Probably more than the grape lady.
I didn't realize.
No, but I go ahead. Let's
well,
do it.
Well,
let's
now,
do it.
Frankly, I like making you skip it.
I like making you uncomfortable.
Well, what am I supposed
thing.
To? Well, what am I? Yeah, right. And now, what do you want me to be? Well, what was going through your head, Bill, when you're getting booed by all those people?
Yeah. You're a really cynical guy, man.
I thought you were down. I thought you were going to be down.
That is a lot for me to say that.
I thought you were going to be down, but it's apparently I'm cynical even to Bill Burr. Shit. Doing something's
burning.
Something's burning.
Oh, you
something's
are.
Burting.
Yeah. Burt's burning. That's why I'm here. He told me, he goes,
God bless Bert. He's such a sweetheart. Do you watch YouTube videos at all?
Hey, G-Sauce, retard here. And is Ethan Klein a joke thief?
No. Greg, are you going to do what H3H3 does, where he goes against his morals for financial gain and then also lies to his viewers a lot? Are you going to do that as well? Also, are you going to steal content ideas off other creators and then use them as your own and not tell anyone?
Shots.
Yikes. Okay.
Well, according to Chad, he is. But Chad's name is also anything for views, so, you know, doesn't exactly add credibility.
Ethan, stop stealing your jokes and stop telling the same ones and you should be good.
Oh, because he stole the Vape Nation meme?
Oh, yeah, tell everyone. Don't tell them where they stole it from. Just say you stole it.
Yeah, please. Yeah. The number one gem of Ethan Klein, Vape Nation, was a stolen idea from a friend, a close friend.
And who's the type of person? Shut up, team. I told you this. You're not allowed to repeat it.
Oh, this is getting spicy. But like, can you be honest with us? Like who'd he take it from? Why are you freaking blueballing me?
Language. Oh, we got something. $3 from Schmeichel44.
We want to Ethan stole a weapon from though.
Oh yeah, I don't know if I can reveal that. But someone that Ethan was friends with.
Oh.
I'm not giving away more than that because I really can't say. Information of who it was isn't out there, so I can't say. Oh, we got something, hang on. $3 from Zark Rios. Oh, well, Keen just gave it away. I just saw in the chat, Keen gave it away. There you go. You got your answer. That's exclusive.
Okay. I mean, Ethan's kind of already admitted that in a way.
One day I was filming with Filthy Frank. And his producer was there, and he was vaping so hard. I was like, dog, what is going on with, like, this vaping? He's like, yeah, man, it's Vape Nation. And I was like, wait, say that again? And I was like, holy fuck, like, that's brilliant. Fucking Vape Nation.
Chad, Keem, can you tell everyone what's going on here exactly? Either that or just don't talk about it at all, because that's just straight drama, bro. Like, what the fuck? Also, quick update. My ex-wife is now pregnant with my brother's child. In the podcast following Ethan's drunken rant about Keemstar, he makes this comment.
By the way, the show, I don't need to clickbait. We're okay, all right? I'm not, like, desperate for more clicks. To put it mildly.
Okay, so I see a humble brag and a way for you to deflect the criticism that you used PewDiePie's controversy to kind of clickbait people and make them watch the podcast. But when somebody else brings up your financial situation, it's a little different.
It was great. No, I'm so happy. Seems like you're doing all right for yourself.
Yeah, we got some walls. We got some curtains.
We're trying.
Yeah. You know, we're trying.
Dude, it's been too
still
long.
Still hustling.
Yikes. Ooh, you really didn't like that. Doesn't take a genius to see you did not like that. To imply that Ethan is making a fuck ton of money from the podcast? That would be crazy. But since John hit a soft spot there, let me poke a little further into it. Ethan, you started the podcast because ad revenue was low. There's nothing wrong with that. If you need money to support yourself, then get it however you need. Just make sure your content doesn't suffer. But let me fill you guys in on a little juicy detail, little piece of nice meat. Do you want to know why Ethan has focused so heavily on the podcast over the last year? Why he hasn't made any original content in the last 4 months? Why his Twitter now links to the podcast channel instead of the main channel? It's because the podcast makes a fuck ton of money. Let me break it down for you. Why is it that almost every YouTuber I know of has started a podcast this year? Well, the answer's pretty simple. They make money. It's because podcasts can get direct sponsors, and direct sponsors make a lot more than just regular content. But here's where the problem arises. Each episode of the H3 podcast has 3 to 4 sponsors. That is insane.
Today's episode is sponsored by MeUndies, Movement, Nature Box, and Dollar Shave Club. This episode is brought to you by Quip. Dollar Shave Club, and of course, my new favorite game on the block, Elder Scroll Legends. Thank you to Dollar Shave Club, Mint Mobile, and ExpressVPN today for sponsoring us. Thank you to our sponsors today, Bull & Branch, Dollar Shave Club, Audible, and Quip.
If I were to be, like, insanely conservative, like fucking Mike Pence levels conservative, I would say that they are making at least $10 per thousand views. At the fucking bare minimum. Then add pre-roll ads, then add the separate clips channel, and then, of course, add, you know, the affiliate links when people actually, you know, purchase the products. That means that an average episode of the H3 podcast is making, conservatively, $20,000. You can think I'm full of shit, but come on.
And then he said, you only put $100,000 on it. I said, abso-fucking-lutely, I put $100,000 on it. Goes to the winner. Winner takes all.
Just think about it. Each podcast episode gets, let's say, average a million, again, conservative. That's a lot of people watching your ads. But again, I have to repeat, there is nothing wrong with that. Just make sure your content does not suffer. That's the equation. That's the trade-off. Make more money, do it how you need, make better content, or at least the same degree. That's how CowChop does it. That's what, you know, most relatively successful communities do. The videos improve over time, but yours don't. You spend an average of 10 full minutes each podcast talking about your sponsors. You know, instead of reading a script and keeping it quick and, you know, saving people some time, you drag it on, you talk about it, you ramble about it with Gila, you know, and it's recorded completely separately of the conversation as well, so it's like a legit commercial break.
Well, short break. We will be back soon with your boy, JonTron. Thank you to MeUndies for sponsoring this episode of the H3 Podcast. Next, we've got Movement and VMT. These guys make the best frickin' watches at the best frickin' prices. No. All right, we'll take a break, guys. Don't leave, because we have got so much great stuff left. If you leave, you blow it. Capish? See you guys soon. Thank you to Nature Box, the most slammin' snacks in town. Nature, here, let me try this. This is the Sriracha Cashew. Oh, my God. Forget about it. Thank you to Dollar Shave Club. One of our greatest, most loyal sponsors. I love Dollar Shave Club. They make a great product.
You know, it doesn't flow very well. It's a legitimate break in the content. And sometimes these breaks are fucking literally 9 minutes long. Such, like, in the Ninja interview.
He was just like, we're just kicking it, you know, gaming.
That's freaking awesome, man.
Yeah, man.
That's so cool. Guys, we're going to take a short break. We will be right back. Do not go away. Do not leave. Dan, cut me off. We'll be right back after this commercial break. See you guys soon. They've got Dr. Carver Shave Butter. This stuff's amazing. Like, oh, I'm going to put fucking, like, whipped cream on my face. You know that shit?
Yeah.
You look like a cream pie. I care about you guys, and I want and wish the best for you. Jesus, I really went on a tangent there.
Like, man, I've heard you ramble about Dollar Shave Club so many fucking times in my life at this point that I'm surprised you don't shoot yourself every time you fucking ramble, honestly, because it's nuts the amount of time you've spent in your life talking about Dollar Shave Club. You don't even shave. So now we understand why the main channel has suffered so much. It's because why fucking bother making high-quality content that takes you potentially hundreds of hours to make, when you're gonna make like $500 off the AdSense? You know, why not just fucking sit down, talk to somebody, or talk to your wife who will barely respond, and, you know, you'll make 20 to 40K in a 2 hour span. That's why the podcast is twice a week. It's so that he can make twice as much money while being half as entertaining. Seriously, though, the podcasts where there's no guest are terrible. Like, they're just fucking, they're just lazy. And your demeanor, it's cynical, it's gross. They consist of you repeating the same jokes, bullying, or complaining. And I'm not nitpicking. This is every, you know, podcast. There's some degree of these three elements. Like, here's an episode, a random episode, and a recent one as well.
We've been having a little bit of a altercation with Prank Invasion.
You remember Prank Invasion? A bit of a meme, yeah.
I'm a pudgy little guy, and Prank Invasion literally just got out of prison for 3 years for some kind of sexual crime.
Holy shit, really?
That is not literally.
Well, I don't know what he... I mean, No, it's a it is a joke.
Oh, it's a joke.
It is a joke. What I'm saying. Do I need to say that every time?
Well, yeah, because your delivery was fucking terrible and lazy. I mean, it's still kind of funny though.
I wouldn't be surprised. Can I say that if you went to prison for a sexual crime?
His jokes are always better the second time.
I wouldn't be surprised if you went to. I wouldn't be surprised at all. I'm anticipating it.
The third.
I am scared of you. That's not like unmanly to admit that I'm scared of some unhinged psychopath who's roided up and just got out of prison for a sexual crime.
Wow, this is fucked.
You literally repeated me saying I was scared that you were in prison for your first sexual crime and were lifting weights that whole time. I wouldn't be surprised at all if that guy went to prison for a sexual crime within the next couple of months.
I could see some rumors starting to pile up that he actually went to prison for a year.
Chris went to prison for a sexual crime?
Yeah.
Chris went to prison for a sexual crime, Ela? It's a joke. He didn't, but I wouldn't be surprised. That's all I'm saying. Can you imagine kissing Chris? His breath is probably so gross. I bet you he has tonsil stones. Any slander about him being a sex criminal that's been in prison for the last couple of years, I'm going to be in contact with his probation officer, and we're going to make sure that those sexual crimes he has committed are not going to be expunged and are going to remain on the sex offender website for a long, long time. Just a joke.
I know that you're joking. It's very obviously a joke. You're saying, look at his face. His face is a rapist face. Look at his dumb rapist face. I think it's one of those jokes you really have to repeat it 1,000 times to really understand where the humor comes from.
He repeats himself in his main videos too, but those get edited down and they're not quite as bad. But what we see on the podcast is just how repetitive he naturally is. Constantly harping on the same joke, fucking letting it drag on for 20 full minutes, and then slowly you start to realize, holy shit, I don't think he's joking, I think he's trying to brainwash me. Hey guys, I'd like to let you in on a little bit of a fucking discovery I've made over these many days of editing this video. You see, much like how iDubbbz coined the phrase the anti-insult for Leafy, I too have discovered a little habit of our good old pal Ethan. Now this one is called the H3 joke. You see, it's clever because the H stands for hypnotize, and then the 3 stands for the number of steps involved. Now step 1 is pretty simple, okay? All you have to do is make a slanderous or damaging comment that is either completely untrue or extremely exaggerated. Something Ethan's more than capable of doing.
And Prank Invasion literally just got out of prison for 3 years for some kind of sexual crime.
And then there's the second step, which is even simpler. Just repeat that comment over and over and over. Really make sure you're drilling it into the head of your viewers.
I wouldn't be surprised, can I say that, if you went to prison for a sexual crime. I wouldn't be surprised if you went to, I wouldn't be surprised at all. I've just got out of prison for a sexual crime. That you were in prison for your first sexual crime. That guy went to prison for a sexual crime. Chris went to prison for a sexual crime.
Yeah.
Chris went to prison for a sexual crime.
And then there's the third step. And you see, the third step is very important because without this, you might get into a little bit of trouble. This is because the third step is to say that it is a joke.
For a long, long time. Just a joke.
Or to say that you love the person or the person is a legend.
Jimmy's a legend. The guy's a legend. He's a legend. Welcome to legend.
You see, this is genius because it allows you to completely slander this person and convince people subconsciously that this person is a bad person or unworthy of their respect. But at the same time, you get to avoid criticism by saying that it's a joke. And of course, the viewers assume that you're honest when you say these things, but in reality, these comments are only meant to put the person down. And the statement of loving them or it being a joke is only meant to cover your ass. Now, knowing these 3 steps, try watching an episode of the podcast and tell me if you can get through a single one without seeing an H3 joke. For me, after watching so many episodes of the podcast, I've realized that Ethan has a very unique skill. He is able to reach a level of 100% sarcasm. Meaning that he can make it to a point where literally he can say one thing and in the mind of his viewers, the exact opposite is interpreted.
Jimmy's a legend. The guy's a legend.
And honestly, this strategy is impressive in a way because instead of using those harsh words, the words that he is actually thinking when he speaks of these people, you know, things like they're a loser, they're a piece of shit, or they're not worthy of your respect, instead of saying that directly to the viewer, he gets to subconsciously imply it and kind of reinforce it in their heads. But by masking it under a heavy layer of sarcasm, you get to avoid any form of criticism, because your exact words are not offensive. The intention is still malicious, but the exact words, you can't call them out for those. Honestly, Ethan, you've kind of inspired me, man, because that's a really good method of making it clear that you hate someone. So to everyone watching, I just want you guys to know that I think Ethan is just a legend. I love that he still makes fun of his fupa, and I think he's just a funny guy overall, to be honest with you. I think his jokes are very creative, and I think he's a very honest person, especially with his fan base. But most importantly, I don't think that the H3 podcast will crash and burn. Ethan? Am I doing it right?
That other guy is asking, if you could sucker punch anyone you wanted from all throughout history, who would you punch and why?
The one person I would say I can't say because of... I can't say. Maybe you can read between. Maybe you can read between the lines, but I can't say.
Okay, I think I know who.
I wouldn't say it publicly because there's just it wouldn't be worth it.
Okay, who's somebody you can say publicly?
I can't. I'm not even going to say it.
Do you just want to punch? I'm not even going to say it.
There's one person in particular, Ela. If you could sucker punch one person, she knows what I'm talking about. I definitely punch this guy. Yeah. I don't need a travel machine to sucker punch this guy.
Vince McMahon.
I
just gotta make a decision.
So that's it. I can't say his name. Otherwise, right. It'll be okay. Bad news.
Fair enough.
But I think hopefully enough people know who I'm talking about. Two to the one, to the one, to the three. I like
the pussy and I like the tree. Smoke. So Ethan has a segment on his podcast where he talks about serious news articles, current events, and this is honestly where I start to lose my sympathy because... this is where Ethan shows that he's a fucking idiot.
In Pennsylvania, there is an epidemic, an actual pedophile ring, okay?
Of priests.
300 priests. I don't know how many priests are in Pennsylvania, but I can't imagine more than like 1,000. I mean, I don't know what's the number, but what was that? What is that? 30%? How can you talk about Pizzagate when the Catholic Church is literally a satanic cult?
Wow, man, you really like exaggerating.
And you're not all in on it? Not just covering it up.
Who is all in on it?
Everybody!
What do you mean?
Everybody. If 30% of the people that work for you are fucking kids, like what reason do you have to keep that system moving? And it's just so funny and ironic to me that people will go slander.
Basically make up stuff.
To you viewers, I really, like, I hope you understand why this is stupid.
I think there's a lot more of these guys fucking kids than just the 300.
Yeah.
Everybody's in on it, bro.
Everybody.
The fucking everybody. The whole church, all the priests, the bishops.
Well, yeah.
I don't know how high the Pope. I mean, I don't know. The Pope? Yeah. Imagine the Pope is raping children, and you're talking about Pizzagate.
So, okay, so he takes random articles, he reads the title, and he reacts to them. And I don't think that he actually reads the articles. He might, but I don't think he does. I think that he has, as you can see on the podcast if you watch them, he has the people who work for him kind of explain the rough ideas of what the article is about. So obviously his opinion is not that informed. And it's not like he's looking at multiple sources or like backing his shit up. It's, you know, just shooting the shit in front of a million people. A million impressionable people.
What exactly does the Catholic Church do except rape kids? I think it's time to close it down. I think it's time to lock shop up on that church. Are you enjoying that tax exemption? Why are we giving them a tax exemption? Let's give them tax exemption.
Here's another one.
Here's the problem with these evil scumbags, these CEOs that run these banks to just fucking pillage the whole world. The government, for whatever reason, has chosen that not to prosecute these criminals, these absolute human parasites. Our government is run by such fucking cowards. And by the way, Donald Trump, Mr. Drain the Swamp, what happened?
I'm just a YouTuber. How does that qualify me to tell you who to vote for? Who to fucking elect as president? I literally go to the grocery stores with 200 shirts on, and you're looking to me for advice on who to vote for president? Yeah, there are got to be better people out here to advise you on that.
Every American wants to see these soulless, evil fucks put in prison. So where's the justice? Why are these people not going to prison for life when one black guy can steal a Mars bar and go to prison for 10 years? Mm-hmm. Why is the swamp not draining? It makes me so angry. Those fucking, oh my God, they're so evil. Why? I don't understand that level of greed. What drives you? You psychopath.
Is the beanie like the new fedora? Did you fucking ruin beanies for me, Ethan?
You know what it is? A normal person, like, we're rich by comparison to someone who's making $30,000 a year. But, like, real rich, we're still normal people because real rich is, like, billionaires. Fulfillment centers having slave-like conditions where workers are pushed to be so productive that they're peeing in bottles because they're actually afraid to take a bathroom break. This isn't America. This sounds like conditions in sweatshops in China. Dude, the more and more I learn about shit...
It's really depressing to hear that about Amazon.
But also, Jeff Bezos is worth nearly $1 trillion. So hire a couple more people. So that's what I mean about these psychopaths.
Yeah, like, the richest man in the world, right?
He's the richest man in the world. And hire more people so people can go to the bathroom. That doesn't even come close to affecting your bottom line. Mm-hmm. When you personally are worth $1 trillion.
Yeah.
Holy fuck, Ethan, you're actually an idiot. Jeff Bezos is worth a fucking $160 billion. A 2-second Google search would have told you that. But, you know what, honestly, you're only off by, like, $840 billion, so fuck it.
If you know anyone who's working class, they're getting fucking slam dunked on by some psychopath billionaire. By the way, the more I learn about, like, stuff, the more I suspect. I'm so skeptical. We work with China on Teddy Fresh, so I started to learn more about what's going on there. They get, in China, a month off. The whole fucking country takes a whole month off. Everything shuts down. You cannot work with these Chinese factories for an entire month. Mm-hmm. The whole country is on vacation. Meanwhile, in America, you always hear like, oh man, sweatshops in China, they're all getting worked out to their fucking teeth. Meanwhile,